Well, our next guest knows the horror of a military helicopter crash all too well. As an ex-soldier, he recovered the body of an army mate when Black Hawk 217 crashed in 1990, killing two people. 3 decades later, he says the memory of that day is still vivid. Dr. Glen Kolomeitz joins us live now from Jarrowa in New South Wales to discuss the Whitsunday's chopper accident. Glen, thanks so much for your time. This will be taking an enormous toll on the Defence Force.
Absolutely, Sarah. Not just the Defence Force broadly, but the people who worked with this crew in Sydney. And of course, the families, mate. It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy.
It absolutely is, and everyone's still sort of coming to terms with it. Obviously, the search efforts have been hampered by those bad conditions, but we know that the Taipans have a bit of a checkered history. I mean, you gave advice to the Howard government on acquiring upgraded Black Hawks. How was that advice received back then?
It was actually to the Labor opposition at the time when I was defence advisor to Labor in opposition. We were briefed by Sikorsky, the manufacturer of Black Hawk, before the Howard government made the decision to buy these MRH-90s. It was received by Labor. It became a policy position at the time, but of course the government of the day went ahead and brought the aircraft.
This tragedy, I guess, does revive those concerns about the technical problems plaguing the MRH Taipan. What are the major safety issues from your perspective?
Look, Sarah, I think without being too speculative, I think we can say that some catastrophic mechanical failure caused this disaster. But if we want a root cause analysis, it goes down to the fact that Defence keeps buying rubbish equipment. And on this occasion, that rubbish equipment has cost lives. That's getting to root causation. The fact that these aircraft have been grounded so often, and in fact were grounded after one of these aircraft ditched in Jarvis Bay not that long ago, Sarah, raises some significant concerns here, mate.
Glen, that's pretty scathing. Why would Defence be making a decision like this?
To buy the aircraft, you mean?
Yeah,
look, there's a whole lot of processes they go through, and Defence acquisition in this country is terrible. It's got a terrible checkered history of buying rubbish. On this occasion, they had the chance to buy similar upgraded platforms to the ones we were operating already for many years, a very good platform, the Black Hawk and the Seahawk. For various reasons, they made the decision to buy these European helicopters, which were never fit for purpose. But it's not just this aircraft. It's almost everything we buy in defence. it defies logic, to be honest, Sarah.
So in your perspective, was this an accident waiting to happen?
Look, I think so. I think so. And this aircraft really, to my view, it should be grounded now. It shouldn't fly again. We're getting new Black Hawks and Seahawks soon, so this thing shouldn't fly again. But look, I think it was. I think the history of this aircraft, the operational problems, it was never fit for purpose. And the fact that one ditched in Jarvis Bay in a few months ago, this thing shouldn't be flying. And that'll come out in the course of investigations.
It's pretty alarming what you're saying, Glen. I mean, you know what you're talking about. You know these aircraft well, and yet the Defence Force should also, yet they're still going ahead with these dangerous... I mean, I'm staggered by what you're saying.
Sarah, years after I left the Army, I was a police officer with the New South Wales Coroner, and I had the lead on the Shark 02 Sea King recovery of the bodies and some of the coronial investigation. And we saw similar approaches by Defence then. When we were trying to investigate that disaster where a number of Australians died... The real lack of transparency and the fact that Defence, they're already closing shop now, you'll find. And look, there needs to be a more open book when it comes to acquiring equipment and when it comes to issues like this this disaster. We, the public, deserve that, and the families deserve that.
Yeah, absolutely, Glen. Let's hope there is more transparency ahead. All right, thank you so much for your insight. Really appreciate it. And if you are a current or former ADF member or a relative in need counselling or support, you can contact the Defence All Hours support line on 1800 628 036 or Open Arms on 1800 011 046.
Something happening right now. A desperate search growing more urgent by the hour for those aircrew missing off Queensland's coast after a military chopper crash. And these are the four faces of this tragedy. Fathers, sons, all highly skilled members of the Army, feared dead this morning.
As the search enters its third day, it's expanding. An exclusion zone off Hamilton Island, now more than 100 square kilometres. The focus also turning to the problem-plagued chopper at the centre of this disaster, grounded for now but won't be phased out until December 2024 despite previous safety issues.
There was an incident earlier this year and we learnt from that and put in place additional mitigations to ensure safety. We only operate our helicopters just like we only operate any capability where we believe that it is safe to do so.
Our reporting team is standing by, starting with Josh Bavis live at Chute Harbour in Queensland. Josh, good morning to you. We're now in our 57th hour.
Yeah, good morning, Carl. That search is entering its third day. The conditions here are moderate. It's quite windy, but at least the weather is clear. The main issue that authorities are battling are the strong currents in and around the Whitsunday Islands. Over the weekend, the rear part of the helicopter was pulled from the water and placed onto a barge, but officials are still searching for the main front part of the fuselage. Up to 800 military personnel were involved in the search over the weekend, and right now, the Australian Navy and the US Navy have ships deployed off the coast of North Queensland. They're offering support to their military assets involved in this search. This is quite a grim operation, but a reminder that any current members or veterans can reach out to the organisation Open Arms if they're being affected by this. Carl?
Josh, thank you.
Let's go now to Gabrielle Boyle at Holsworthy Barracks in Sydney's southwest. Gabby, we're learning more about the men this morning.
We are, Sarah, four very accomplished, very professional young men who simply went to work and sadly did not come home. And now we fear the worst. Those men, Captain Daniel Lyon, Lieutenant Maxwell Nugent, Warrant Officer Joseph Laycock and Corporal Alexander Nags. I think Jackie Lambie summed up the feeling of all Australians at the moment.
I just want those people out there to know you've got a lot of support, those families out there, and you've always been our hearts. So
it's fair enough.
I know you've got a very, very long week, but we are all thinking about you.
And of course, our thoughts not only with their friends and family at this very difficult time, but their many colleagues here at the Holsworthy Barracks. Sarah?
Absolutely, Gabby. Thank you.
Well, four Sydney soldiers lost after an army helicopter crash off North Queensland have now been identified.
The search continues this morning for Daniel Lyon, Maxwell Nugent, Warrant Officer Class 2 Joseph Laycock and Corporal Alexander Nags. Veterans Affairs and Defence Personnel Minister Matt Keogh joins us now in Canberra. Matt, thanks for your time. Our heart goes out to the families of those missing. Do you have any updates?
Good morning. As you would appreciate, our key focus right now is the search for our missing soldiers, and that search continues. It involves Australian Defence personnel, our friends in the United States, as well as Queensland Emergency Services personnel are involved in that search. That is our key focus right now. But we're also focused on providing support to the families of our missing soldiers as well, and to the broader defence family that they come from, in particular their Unit 6 Aviation in New South Wales.
The hardest of tasks, I mean, trying to look for fallen soldiers. Can you explain the complexities of it?
Well, obviously, an offshore search area where there are some reasonably strong currents makes it difficult, and the incident occurred at night, and that adds complexity. We've now started to recover some debris from the incident, and that assists, and we've deployed even further additional capability to the area to build on that search, which is still ongoing, and the air safety investigation people are on site as well, starting their work. But the key focus is the search for the personnel. It is difficult, but everyone is really committed to that task. There are, of course, people involved in that search that are part of the defence family of these four missing soldiers, and so they're very committed to making sure that we can complete this search as quickly as possible.
Yeah, and there's a huge team going into that effort as well. I mean, it's just another reminder, isn't it, of the enormous sacrifices of our military personnel.
Look, all defence activity brings with it some inherent risk. We always seek to conduct these sorts of exercises, training and missions in the safest possible way and with all mitigations that can be employed, but there will be risk involved, and it highlights, especially with this group that operate with our special forces, that they do dangerous things and they have to train for those dangerous things as well. And it's important that they do that so that they are the most effective capability that they can be. But it does mean that there is a risk that things like this can occur.
We can't imagine what the families are going through this morning, but families will want answers. How long will it take for you to provide them?
Certainly, the family will want answers, as will the entire Defence Force. We want to make sure, whenever any sort of accident occurs, that we understand the causes, what sits behind that, and to make sure that we can ensure these sorts of things don't happen in the future. So we're conducting the search. The air safety investigation is also underway, and that will help inform us to make sure things like this don't happen and so that answers can be provided. But the investigation will take some time, and our key priority right now is the search and supporting the families as well. And I do encourage anybody in the Defence Force or their families or veterans that need to speak to somebody that require assistance to reach out to Defence Member and Family Helpline or to Open Arms so they can get the support that they need.
Matt, to Carl's point there, I think we are all asking for a bit more transparency here. We had a former soldier on the show earlier who was talking about these aircrafts not necessarily being as safe as they should be for our personnel. What do you have to say about that? He was concerned that the ADF isn't making the right decisions in terms of defence acquisition here.
Well, certainly in the aftermath of what has occurred, that fleet of helicopter has been grounded whilst we seek to determine what has happened and whether further mitigations need to be put in place to ensure their continued safe operation. There was an incident earlier this year and we learnt from that and put in place additional mitigations to ensure safety. We only operate our helicopters just like we only operate any capability where we believe that it is safe to do so. Safety is a terribly important thing for us, given that there is inherent risk. We seek to minimise that risk in everything we do. The fleet is being replaced at the end of next year. That goes to a range of capability issues that have been experienced with the MRH-90 over time, and we will be getting a new capability in the Black Hawk. But what we are focused on right now is the search. We will then look to learn what needs to be put in place to continue operation of the helicopter through to their retirement. But our focus is on the search right now and supporting the family and loved ones of our soldiers that are missing, and of course supporting their wider defence family as well, in particular their unit, 6 Aviation.
All right, mate, yeah, a lot of questions to be answered there about the safety of those aircraft, that's for sure. Thanks so much for your time. And if you are a current or former ADF member or a relative and need counselling or support, you can contact the Defence All Hours support line on 1800 628 036 or Open Arms on 1800 011 046.